The following program is rated 14 plus and contains mature subject matter. Viewer discretion is advised.
The West Coast is burnt.
The air was so polluted that I didn't feel it was safe.
Communities flooded out, wiped out.
A climate catastrophe.
It's apocalyptic.
It's really scary to imagine it worse than it is now.
On our own doorstep. Canada is very, very far from its climate change target.
It's an issue that's so serious that we need to take action now.
Eight Canadians from cities across the country have had enough.
What are we raising our kids into? What are we birthing children into? What are we doing?
I got one hell of a chip on my shoulder against the generation before me.
And they're leading the fight for tomorrow.
No, it's not too late. We still have about 10 years to make a change.
We are the last generations who can do something about it. So it's up to us to take action and really save the planet.
Many of us are worried about our future, but it's our children who will witness it. And some aren't standing by to inherit a country past the point of saving. Thousands of young people have taken to the streets in Canada in recent years, striking to change the way adults in power are handling the climate crisis.
I care about the climate crisis because it's going to affect my future. What's the point of going to school if we don't have a future to prepare for?
At only 13 years old, Sophia Mather represents a generation with the greatest hope of uniting us.
When I was 11 years old, I heard about Greta Thunberg and the Fridays for Future movement, and I just automatically wanted to be a part of that. I asked my mom if I could start striking, and she said, maybe we'll see about it. But I convinced them to let me strike every first Friday of the month. And now I'm where I am today.
This award is for all those millions of people, young people around the world, who together make up the movement called Fridays for Future.
A good day in the climate movement is probably when you're surrounded by people who treat the crisis like a crisis.
My first strike was the first strike outside of Europe. And so that was the first strike in Canada, the first strike on basically this side of the planet.
With Fridays for Future Sudbury leading the way in North America, there have now been strikes in over 70 Canadian cities.
I never really thought of being a leader when I started striking.
Here, Maggie, do you want to start off that
way? All right. I just started striking, and it never really got to my head that I was part of the first people who started the movement.
Sophia is striking today because she knows there's no vaccine for climate change.
And even though now there's a pandemic, we can still do stuff like set up a shoe stripe. Since we can't have mass rallies, we put shoes there representing a whole bunch of people. Youth are taking all this action. We're putting all our effort and trying to get governments to take action. And I'm doing the best I can, and I think that I'm doing enough, but governments are not.
Our impact is causing unimaginable damage to the planet. But when it comes to talking just about Canada, it's even worse than you think.
There's all sorts of opinion about how Canada is doing, I would say, quite badly, actually.
Canada is one of the worst emitters that exist on the planet per capita.
It's only Australia and Canada that, you know, compete between themselves with the US for the first worst country of the world.
At the root of the problem are the places over 80% of Canadians call home, our cities.
Will this council have the courage to stand up for the long-term public interest?
Former Mayor of Toronto David Miller knows this all too well.
Well, the interesting thing, and it's not often very well known, is that a massive proportion of the world's greenhouse gases come from cities. About 70% come from cities or from the activities needed to sustain them. In general terms, it's in four areas: transportation, how we heat and cool buildings, how we manage our waste, and how we generate electricity.
As the growth of Canadian cities shows no signs of slowing, their contribution to the climate crisis grows with them. And it's getting harder and harder to change direction.
The biggest challenge in urban areas from a transportation perspective, both from greenhouse gases and air pollution, is the single-family automobile.
There are 35 million cars in Canada, close to one for every person. In Toronto alone, over a third of the city's emissions come from cars. Even where transit is an option, Canadians are still choosing to drive.
In North America, we are definitely very reliant on cars. My family is all from China. My aunts and uncles, none of them own cars. The idea that you could be a one or two kid family and own two cars is outrageous. That doesn't exist for most people in China.
Can you pack me a straw?
That one?
Yeah,
one straw.
I'm one of the founding members of the New Westminster Babies for Climate Action, and I'm currently mom to one and soon to be two.
You good to go?
There's a lot of unique challenges and realities that are faced by people with young children.
Can you unlock the car, please?
I think a lot of the narrative that we are fed is about doing your part, doing the things that you can do. Things like driving an electric car, riding a bicycle instead of using your car. Those are all things that are great for some people and very, very difficult for women with young children. The fact that you have to drive a larger car because you have to cart your kids around because that's your life. And especially women who are working multiple jobs or who are lower income, how are you going to afford an electrical car so that you can do your part for the climate crisis? It's not possible.
And cars aren't the only convenience we've come to depend on. Canada's energy consumption is five times higher per capita than the world average. Our electricity use per capita is almost six times greater than any other country. And to top it off, Canadians produce more garbage per person than anyone else on the planet.
People are consumed and stuck in this never-ending cycle of consumption.
We've become a throwaway society. Everybody knows it's wrong. You got all this packaging.
There are certain pressures in society to, you know, to wear the right clothes or to go on the right vacations.
Do we really need the air conditioning all summer long? Not necessarily.
We could all do with a lot less. And maybe we just don't want to.
The collective effect of this has caused a massive leap in emissions. And while the climate naturally changes over long periods of time, human impact is speeding it up. Over the past 75 years, Canada's average temperature has risen more than double the global rate.
And this is part of the urgency we climate scientists have, is we want to act now before we push the climate envelope to temperatures in the future that human society will have a very hard time dealing with.
We've actually changed the chemistry of the atmosphere. And even as dire as the extreme weather events that are occurring today are, they're going to get even more challenging in the future, period. The reality of climate change is really coming to roost in tangible terms. So what we might have thought was the one in 100 year flood or the one in 50 year flood, that may now be the one in 20 year flood. Flooding is the number one cost to Canada in terms of the expression of climate change extreme weather risk. The average cost of a flooded basement in Canada today is somewhere in the order of about $42,000 to $43,000.
Moving forward, Canada is expected to spend over $900 million each year on natural disaster relief, 75% of it going toward flooding alone.
That's money that could have bought beds in a hospital, or it could have built a new recreation center somewhere, or we could have used to restore a bridge somewhere. So we've got this damage that's totally preventable, and we're not acting nearly aggressively enough to put the measures in place to stop the risk, and I find that enormously frustrating.
But our cities aren't just drowning. They're suffocating and burning to death too. The lifestyles we've created in the biggest cities in Canada are wrecking the planet. Every year, homes and communities are being destroyed by record-breaking storms and flash floods. But there is another devastating effect of extreme weather: heat.
Projections for extreme heat in Canada are dire. Several years ago, during a heat wave event in Quebec, 90 people died during a heat wave. And not to be indelicate, but those 90 people died under good conditions, i.e. the electricity was running. Had there been electricity outage combined with that heat wave, and no air conditioning available or no fans running, those deaths would have been in the high hundreds, if not the thousands.
Heat is one of the deadliest killers among natural disasters. 2020 saw the hottest July ever recorded in the Northern Hemisphere, and daily temperatures in many Canadian cities hit new highs. And where there's heat, there's fire.
The entire city of Slave Lake, Alberta, burnt to the ground. Fort McMurray, you know, the center of big oil in Canada, burnt to the ground.
Vancouver's choking under smoke from the wildfires on the West Coast, and they have, I think, the number one worst air quality in the world right now, which is insane.
2018 was BC's worst fire season on record. Six of the province's 10 biggest wildfires have happened in the last 20 years. And the smoke pollution impacts us well after the fires are put out.
Climate change was not covered at all when I was in medical school. Seeing what was happening around me spurred me to join the board of the Canadian Association of Physicians for the Environment and start to become more active on climate change. People who are exposed to natural disasters like forest fires do suffer more longer-term health consequences and immediate health consequences. It's a huge toll on people's health.
Hi, Jenny. I'm Dr. Melissa Lam. I'm one of the doctors who works at the clinic here. How are you today?
So I noticed that when I go outside and I walk down the street, I've been having shortness of breath.
Mm-hmm. Okay, how long has that been for?
It's been going on for about 2 weeks.
And that's right around when the smoke started.
Yeah.
I think climate change really hit home for a lot of people in Vancouver during those intense forest fires of 2017 and 2018. The sky was gray and yellow, and we couldn't see the North Shore Mountains anymore. In 2017, I think people thought this is a one-off. Next year we'll get back to normal. It was just a blip. But then another record-breaking year came. I saw people come in with more asthma exacerbations. I saw patients coming in with runny noses and sore throats all the time. I myself walked around with the constant feeling of a sore throat and congestion. The fine particulate causes inflammation almost immediately. The air quality lowers immediately. So it's an immediate response. If this is not a wake-up call, I don't know what it's going to take to get people to act on it.
And this is not new stuff. You know, I'm 43 and I got one hell of a chip on my shoulder against the generation before me. I think previous generations used up a lot of resources.
I'm very worried about the science of climate change, because the science shows we have to more or less cut global emissions in half by 2030. We measure things from 1990. because that's sort of the date that the world agreed that we needed to start lowering emissions. If we'd started then, the transition would have been really, really straightforward and pretty simple. Now it's dramatic.
Even if we turn the tap off tomorrow, we're still locked into, I mean, science can't even answer how long we're locked into the current climate change that we've already committed to after 500 years of industrialization. And you know, the longer we wait, that time frame could be a millennia. It could be two millennia. We don't know how long this carbon that we've already burnt is going to stay in the atmosphere and how long it's going to disrupt our ability as humankind to live on Mother Earth.
The sheer size and complexity of this problem is also causing another one that science has been struggling with since climate change hit headlines over 30 years ago.
I'm a professor in biology at McGill University, where I hold the Canada Research Chair on Climate Change Mitigation and Tropical Forests. It's a challenge for us scientists to know how can we share with the public complex scientific fact in a way that allows them to understand and see the problem as we see it. You cannot just publish paper. People don't read papers. I mean, just a few scientists read the paper of other scientists. If you want to share the knowledge you've built over the years, you have to speak with people and try to engage with them.
Professor Catherine Ponfin speaks to her students at McGill University often about their future.
So I guess I invited you to come and to speak together because I sort of wanted to get your feeling about climate change.
I think the whole concept of climate change and the state of the world these days is terrifying.
The messaging around climate change isn't getting across because it's a lot of, it's focused on scary things and make people feel hopeless.
Obviously, it's not a productive emotion. Like, it stops you from going forward and being innovative and thinking positively.
We made people very scared. We made people very concerned. But this did not translate into action. And now there is research that is showing that making people too scared fosters inaction because people are like, oh, the problem is too big anyway. I'm not going to resolve that. And as a result, people just give up.
But as scientists fight the paralysis caused by the facts of the climate crisis, it's not the whole story.
It's not all on us. It's not even mostly on us. We're being let down by people who have more power and more money than us, and we're made to feel like it's our fault.
Mother Earth was never the perpetrator of the crime, it was the scene of the crime. Those who were most affected by the climate crisis had the least control.
Supporters of the fossil fuel regime have duped the public into believing that that somehow changing your light bulbs or you know, recycling your plastic bottles is, you know, or buying an electric vehicle is going to solve climate change.
The fact that oil companies have known since the 1980s, and for sure since the 1990s, that their byproduct, which is the carbon dioxide of burning the fossil fuel, is causing a major disaster on the climate, is morally unacceptable. Because they are doing harm, fully knowing they're doing harm. And I would push it one step further. The governments that support these oil companies, knowing fully well how much harm this is doing, because the science is unequivocal, they are also doing something that is morally unacceptable.
In the end, the villain's greed. It's incredibly wealthy companies and people wanting even more for their own personal financial self-interest, not the world's, not even their families, not even their grandchildren's, let alone everybody else's. This relatively small group was rich enough to be able to fight like mad, to sow confusion. That was their only goal. Let's confuse the issue so nobody acts. And you know what? They were pretty damn successful.
The climate crisis is inching us closer to an uninhabitable country. A problem that for many feels overwhelming.
What I would like people to know is that no, it's not too late. If every one of us, we do our share and adopt climate solution, we can avoid the worst.
I think it's important to think globally, like be aware of what's happening, but then act locally, like start small.
Even if you're taking small actions, it does make a big difference, because if a whole bunch of people take small actions, then it leads to a big difference. I'm very nervous that maybe there'll be an issue, like a politician won't show up, but I'm also very excited. It was pretty tiring to wake up pretty early to set up, but honestly, it's worth it. A lot of things have changed since my first strike. Our city declared the climate emergency. We lobbied them about that. I'm now part of a lawsuit that's suing the Ford government for not taking enough action on the climate crisis, and they weren't doing enough to protect our future.
Ever since Sophia was born, there's been something really special about her. She's got the courage of a lion. She just knows this can be solved.
Hello, my name is Sophia Mather. We must listen to the experts and cooperate. It's been 2 years, people. We want action. Climate change is going to affect future generations. We definitely need to think about that, because if we're just thinking for ourselves, and that's just not fair.
Just recovery for all.
Just recovery for all.
We are the ones who are gonna have to feel the effects of climate change. So we have a strong voice on this. Seeing youth out there fighting for their future can empower a lot of people.
Some of the strongest and loudest voices come from those who have been on this land the longest. Canada's Indigenous communities make up just 5% of the population, but they're leading this fight.
We're not running out of time. I mean, I think a lot of white folks or people of European descent gravitate towards that idea. But for brown and black and Indigenous peoples, I mean, shit, we ran out of time generations ago. You know, we continue to live in crisis. I'm a Cree man from Pugitawagan Cree Nation, Treaty 6 territory. However, I live here in the city of Winnipeg in Treaty 1 territory. You know, ever since I was just a little guy, I've always been fighting for, you know, if I see something that's unjust, then I'll name it and call it out. And that's just always the way I've been. I started my career as an organizer here in Winnipeg. My older brothers started the largest Native gang in the country, the Manitoba Warriors. And so my first job was running a drug house for that gang. I went and got an education and turned my life around and got involved in helping young Indigenous peoples get out of gangs in the inner city. For the last 20 years, you know, I've been organizing with hundreds of Indigenous communities from the North Slope of Alaska to the Gulf of Mexico to try and stop the encroachment of fossil fuel corporations into their traditional territory.
So right now, I'm going to place you under arrest.
You know, there's 350 million Indigenous peoples across the planet, and the places that we call home are the last remaining places where the world's biodiversity is at its strongest. There's a moment that's happening here where our government is going to be faced with a decision dilemma. Do they double down on a dying industry? Or do we do this in the right way and actually honor our commitments that we've made to Canada's First Nations peoples? We have an opportunity in the so-called silent majority for them to actually hear the message that Native people have been trying to share for so long.
While activists like Clayton battle the government to shift away from fossil fuels, others are taking a more grassroots approach.
Climate justice and food justice are intertwined in many ways. One of those ways is rising food costs. Another way is where food can be grown and how food is grown. Is the food being grown in an ecological way that respects the earth, or are large swaths of pesticides being sprayed on it and those pesticides are running off into our water that we consume? So welcome to the greenhouse. These are my crops that I grow. This is a type of salad mix. It's not the normal salad mix you see in the supermarket because I feel like it's kind of boring. Urban farming is important within cities for a host of reasons.
So here's your salad mix.
Farming is one of the largest causes of greenhouse gases. And if someone buys my tomato, it's replacing a supermarket tomato that has to be shipped in from California or Mexico.
So these are like two bunches. Let me band them for you.
Okay.
But urban agriculture does more than provide food, and I do provide a lot of food year round. But I also think that the ethical piece needs to be in there, whether that be paying your workers a fair living wage and not using volunteers or interns, but ultimately also respecting the original land stewards of this land, indigenous people. And if my role in farming could be in an ecological way to help support climate justice, I felt like that was the right thing to do.
At just 23 years old, Cheyenne Sundance owns Toronto's first year-round farm with a focus on social justice. And selling her seasonal produce is just the start.
Having a community garden or a larger scale urban farm in every ward in Toronto would really allow local youth and just people to have access to healthy food, but also have access to education and an example of what urban agriculture could look like. Toronto has 7 golf courses, 5 of them are city-owned. A golf course in Toronto is about 150 acres. That's a lot of acreage, considering that 1 acre farms can produce a lot of food. So I love the idea of turning golf courses into farms. I'm hopeful that a big army of youth will come in and say, I'm starting an urban farm or a rural farm or a beekeeping business. I'm hopeful that these projects can be something. They may not change the climate crisis completely, but they will still have a big stake in it.
Cheyenne is already inspiring those around her to take action in urban Canada.
David Miller.
But what if one of our biggest problems, cities themselves, could also contain the solution? Energy, transit, electricity, garbage. 70% of global emissions come from cities. But cities have something else, the power to take action for themselves.
I just had really good news, by the way. The Canadian government's gonna host an event at the UN about our report that we just wrote about a just and green recovery from COVID. It's a really big deal.
David Miller is trying to affect change from the inside, putting to work the knowledge gained from his time as leader of Canada's largest city.
Our house is on fire. Is our economy driving inequality and environmental disaster?
He's part of a worldwide network of cities known as C40.
C40 is a global organization of mayors. The founding principle of the organization is that the actions and the voices of the mayors of the world's largest cities can make a very real difference to climate change.
We're going to get a chance to speak at the UN, so that's pretty exciting.
C40 started with 40 members in 2005, but now has 97. Toronto, Montreal, and Vancouver, home to over 1/3 of Canadians, are all members.
Our mayors are really important, particularly now, because what we've seen is national governments, even ones that say the right thing, failing to act with the urgency and speed necessary to address climate change. You can contrast that with the actions of mayors and cities. Cities and local governments are responsible for transit. They're responsible for building standards. They're responsible for water. We have seen really superb climate action from a number of cities. Calgary, you know, the heart of Canada's oil industry, started buying its electricity from wind. Montreal is doing some really interesting work about ensuring that people can get around the city by foot and by bicycle and by public transit and don't have to own a car. Vancouver is a global leader in standards for new buildings. It's quite remarkable what they're doing to ensure low carbon construction moving to zero. But of course, I'm partial to Toronto. It's doing very well on buildings, very well on waste management. Transit planning, there's been some really good stuff, some setbacks, but it's moving along to an electrified, clean path. There's a wonderful system called Deep Lake Water Cooling in Toronto, in which cold water is used instead of natural gas or electricity to cool commercial buildings in the summer. One of the things that struck me over the years is when we do things that people see, feel, and touch, particularly if they're part of it, you get a collective feeling that we're all in it together. It gives them pride. And it also allows a mayor more latitude to do the right thing.
And among C40's key priorities is to ensure no one is left behind.
Not everybody is experiencing the climate crisis the same way. And not everybody can afford to do the same things to mitigate the climate crisis. And I don't think that those are issues that we can ignore.
Across Canada, the poorest people are the ones that are bearing the cost of the problems with climate change. In Montreal, for example, when we think about very hot episodes of heat in summer, the poorest neighborhood of town are almost deprived of trees and parks, which have a cooling effect. This is absurd since the rich people, they're not even in Montreal over summer.
How do we address environmental challenges in a way that benefits everybody, particularly the least well off? That's really critical, because if you don't help people have opportunity who need it the most, they're not going to help you solve your environmental problems either.
There's a right way to do it and a wrong way to do it. And I think that the right way to do it is through respecting community self-determination and making sure that, whatever transition that we make, that we're putting those impacted by the transition first in line.
My favorite part of becoming a farmer, especially with Sundance Harvest, is that I get to teach the next generation of young farmers.
At Sundance Harvest, what I focus on with my fertilizing is soil health. Fertilizers like these, it actually has organic seaweed and has kelp.
Those who are most marginalized in the food system are, statistically speaking, Black and Indigenous people.
You're welcome to come in and explore the greenhouse if you want.
So it's very important to teach marginalized communities how to farm. To give youth the practical skills that they need to start their own movements. To dismantle the systems of oppression, food insecurity, colonialism, and the food system, you must have the tools to recreate your own systems in a just and beautiful way.
We will be fertilizing with chicken manure pellets. Here you go. Here you go. What you want to do is you want to pretend you're sprinkling salt on a nice dish. You want to get it around the base of the plant, never on the leaves. And you want to circle the plant.
When I was around 16 in high school, I started understanding what climate change was and also understanding my role in fighting it. I felt overall angry. And I feel like anger is a thing that a lot of people tell teenagers not to have, to relax, to not be angry, to calm down or chillax and stuff like that. And I felt like that anger that I had at 16, I did something with it. And I started wanting to speak out, be an advocate, do as much as I could. And then also it ultimately led me to be a farmer. I never saw myself reflected in agriculture. I had no examples whatsoever. I didn't even know that I could farm in the city. But what if I had a community garden on my block and I saw some really great role models growing food and they taught me how to grow food? Maybe I would be a farmer quicker.
Growing up in Toronto, being Black, being a young woman, kind of having to make space for yourself, it means so much for me to have someone who's already started to break down the barriers so to make it easier for other people to walk through.
Getting a chance to just connect with these guys, see what their projects are about. It's fun and it's inspiring. It's just every time I come here, I'm so excited to visualize my end goal.
Well,
what you do is you'd put a sandbag on the earth.
It's really touching and humbling to see a lot of the youth in my programs look up to me as a role model, and I would have never thought my entire life I would be that, mainly because I didn't do really well in school. I love that I get to see these beautiful farms, these community gardens sprout up in Toronto. So I get to help shape and mold their projects. I get to be their mentor along their way.
In the end, our lawmakers can have the biggest impact on preventing environmental catastrophe. But we all have the power to be role models.
You know, there's 101 different ways to take action.
Action feels better than anxiety. So starting very small in your household, you can waste less, buy less, consume less, eating less meat, active commuting, driving less.
Composting, dry hanging your laundry, buying from local businesses and supporting local farms.
Protesting and, you know, putting pressure on decision makers, you know, going into an MP's office and sitting down and demanding to meet with the MP until they meet with you.
Voting, exercising your democratic right is incredibly important.
The main thing people can do is start to educate themselves.
We still have about 10 years ahead of us to make a change. And the stakes are too big not to try.
What is that growing on the ground over there?
Nature was really a refuge for me when I was young. When I was in nature, I could really be myself. I felt like it was safe. I felt like it was just a place where I could really just let go and relax. So when I was very young, I really formed that connection to nature. When people are more nature connected, they're more likely to behave in pro-environmental ways.
Look how tall it is.
It's probably 9 meters tall.
9 meters tall. I think it might be a little taller than that.
Then 10 meters?
When it's 2050, my son is going to be in his 30s, around the same age I am now. I want to be able to look at him in the eye when he grows up and say to him, I did everything that I could when you were young to I'm like, I'm going to start crying.
If you want to go bearing, you want
to
know.
I want to be able to tell him I did everything I could when you were young to stop this from happening.
We're raising kids in a time that's pretty scary. Like, we know that this is a crisis and we know that it's getting worse and worse. So what are you doing bringing people into the world to face this future?
And you're pregnant, congratulations. Oh, I'm so excited for you.
There was a few parents who were just dealing with like the guilt. We got together to kind of talk about what can we do? What are some tangible things we can do to make it feel like we're not, you know, doing nothing, that we're not failing our kids actively all the time.
It's kind of difficult. Everybody's got a lot of stuff going on. Everybody's a mom, everybody's got young kids. So whenever we can get together, it's like, you have an hour, your childcare expires, the coach turns back into a pumpkin.
I'd love to say that, you know, Babies for Climate Action is going to be responsible for changing the course of, you know, dealing with the climate crisis, but that's not going to happen. But on the other hand, we are empowered through the loudness of cute baby voices and children to be heard. This is my child. He's going to be 2 next month, and he's, you know, going to grow up in this world. What are we going to do to protect him?
Any parent that isn't worried about their kid's future right now is living in a pretty big delusion.
I want to get as many of those shells as we can.
Clams.
Yeah.
I think we should all be really concerned about the future generations.
Oh yeah, that's a good one.
I want them to have the same experiences that I had growing up with my great-grandparents and like picking berries and eating berries in the bush till I threw up. And like going out on the lake and pulling up the nets and eating fresh fish on the shore.
So what I want to do is I want to cut some really nice earrings
Do you?
You know, freshwater clam earrings.
Yeah.
I think that'd be really beautiful.
The main thing that I focus on teaching my sons is the consequences, the potential consequences of the choices that they could make. But I also try to not impose my political or spiritual ideology on my sons. For the most part, they're more radical than I am. I mean, they're like right there, you know, at all the protests. And, you know, my sons have both been on Parliament Hill and spoke on the mic to thousands and thousands of protesters. You know, everyday people gotta take the leadership from some of these young people that have been participating in climate strikes across the country.
We're gonna be doing a dance. It's called Chaya Chaya. Arjun is the one who made it, but I'm introducing it right now. Seeing youth out on the streets striking for their futures, striking for climate change, spreading a positive message about an issue that is serious, it's possible that we could fix this future.
There's no reason why this cannot be solved other than lack of imagination and lack of political will. So let's just get that going for the sake of our children.
Woo! You guys, woo! Best shoe strike yet, that's for sure.
I am proud of her. You know, it's the job of every parent to help their children find their gifts. She's obviously found hers. Of course I'm proud.
I've never felt like I've taken on too much, and I don't think that my childhood has been taken away from me. Through this process of being a climate activist, even though it is a serious process, I have had fun during the journey. I dream of becoming a lawyer one day, and I think that hopefully, if I have children one day, they may ask me what I did during the situation of climate change, and I'll be able to say that I took action and I was a part of the movement that protected the future generations from the climate crisis.
Next time on VeraCity.
Another night of gun violence in the
were
city.
Flying, sending...
What we're seeing now is more like terrorism.
How hard is it to find a gun in Toronto?
It's not hard at all. Kids have them.
Where are the guns coming from?
The smuggling routes is as much as you can imagine.
How many guns do you think would fit in there?
The worst thing I ever did was smuggle guns into Canada.